Neuroscience proves the benefits of ADHD and autism. Geeky Science with Richard Silberstein. Check it out, leave your comments, ring the bell, share it with your friends, and subscribe to our channel. I have been looking forward to this conversation for weeks. An old friend of mine, Professor Richard Silberstein, the founder and board chairman and chief scientist at Neuro-Insight, a professor emeritus at Swinburne University in Melbourne, Australia, where he served as chairman of the physics department and later the founding director of the Brain Sciences Institute, has written this absolutely new, brilliant new piece. He published it over at medium.com, and it's titled The Neuroscience of the Creative Geek. And so on the line with us from Australia is Professor Richard Silberstein. Richard, welcome back to the program. It's been a couple of years, I think, since you've been on. Tell us about, first of all, who is this creative geek? I mean, what are we talking about here that you're writing about?
Well, from here, from Australia, good morning, Thom. The creative geek is the characters that you often come across, certainly in the sciences, for example. Some of the most creative individuals seem to have certain common characteristics to varying degrees. One of them, for example, of course, is highly creative. The other one is, you know, remarkable ability, particularly in the science and technology areas. Now, in addition to that, quite often there are evidence of being on the autistic spectrum, what used to be called Asperger's syndrome or sort of high-functioning autism. That was the term that was used. And there was also a common feature of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. Now, at first I thought these were just accidental combinations, but the more I thought about it, particularly in relation to the work that we'd been doing on looking at the link between ADHD and creativity, the more I thought there was a reason why these sort of characters, slightly eccentric, rather gauche, but brilliant in their particular areas. You see a lot of them in Silicon Valley and also universities. Those are the sort of people I'm talking about. In extreme cases, Alan Turing, for example, the person who really invented the computer, even people like Albert Einstein, Newton, and others, Elon Musk, for example, would have many of those characteristics as well. They're the sort of people that I'm talking about, people who've actually made enormous contributions to civilization over an enormous period of time.
Yet they struggle in their personal lives.
Yep. Essentially, what they have, the autistic syndrome, is in fact one of the key features that contributes to their creativity. Now, there's a theory that a Cambridge professor, Professor Baron Cohen, has presented, which I think really captures an important feature about why people on the autistic spectrum seem to have a feel for science and technology, and that is that there are sort of two modes of thinking, if you will, what he calls the empathizing mode and the systematizing mode. Now, empathizing, essentially seeing the world in terms of human relationships, understanding other people, etc., whereas the systematizing is more looking at the world as sort of abstract objects almost and relationships, you know, input, output, etc., a more abstract way, impersonal way of looking at the world.
Now, are these categories, Richard, that years ago we referred to as left brain, right brain, or as male dominant, female dominant?
I think what Baron Cohen suggests is that the male dominant and female dominant looks like it really holds up. There is an element of the left-right brain element to it as well, although these days we now seem to realize that both left and right hemispheres of the brain seem to contribute to both aspects. But certainly there's an element of the left and right brain, with the left brain, for example, being more associated with looking at the world as objects, etc., and right brain more looking at the world as a whole, and also appreciating facial expression and human relationships. So there's an element to both of those. They're a bit of oversimplification, but there's an element to both of those. So that right brain, left brain, but more importantly, sort of male-female, is the sort of thing that Baron Cohen suggested was what was happening. Now, the intriguing thing is that one of the deficits that we see in autism and the Asperger syndrome is that they have a difficulty in essentially they're very strong in terms of the systematizing, but the systematizing part is much more dominant than the empathizing aspect. And so being able to recognize intuitively other people's feelings at the time that you're talking, etc., comes less naturally. It can be taught, but it comes less naturally. So they tend to have difficulty with, for example, conversation, parties, for example, and also to a degree, relationships as well.
That's me. I am terrified by cocktail parties and small groups of people. I don't know what to do. But in any case, we're always looking for neat little categories to put people in, and I suspect that none of us fit into neat little categories. But it sounds like what you're suggesting is that for these folks, their ability to understand things is kind of mechanically understanding, you know, okay, this goes to that and that goes to this, and I can draw a schematic in my head and understand it. The kind of skill set that helps in math and science and physics and things like that is a completely separate skill set from, you know, why is Sally upset? You know, why is John's frowning? You know, what does that mean? How should I respond? And that for most people, those two skill sets are relatively balanced. But among these folks, the systematizing skill set is, or talent or ability or whatever you want to call it, is exaggerated, and the empathizing one is diminished. Do I have that right?
That's exactly correct. That's exactly what Baron Cohen is suggesting.
How does this produce? I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I think I was going to get to your question, actually. How does that produce greater creativity in the sciences?
Exactly.
Is that what you were thinking? Right. Well, okay.
Yep.
We need to go back a little bit and just have a look at how do we come up with creative ideas? Now, we now understand that there's a network within the brain called the default mode network. This network of regions in the brain becomes active, lights up, when you're doing nothing much in particular, just relaxing, daydreaming, etc. Now, that is the network that, one, is overactive in people with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And that actually is one of the reasons that causes them to sort of lose track on focusing on a boring task, etc. But it is also the network that comes up with new ideas. And any time you think of a problem, that network, unconsciously, you don't even have to be aware of it, will start working on the problem. It'll sort of put ideas together that you've already got from your memory, etc., and come up with various possible solutions. And generally, there are lots of possible solutions, most of which probably don't work, to a problem. Now, that's what your default mode network is doing, this network. Now, there's another network that decides whether the solution is really good enough for you to even become aware of it. And I refer to that as simply the judgment network. Once again, that also operates unconsciously. And when your default mode network comes up with an idea which it regards, the judgment network regards as good enough, it pops into your head as an idea, and you go, aha, wow, I've solved it. So that's what's happening with the creative process. Now, one of the reasons people, for example, sometimes dry up and become uncreative under certain circumstances is that judgment network just becomes overactive. If you're anxious, for example, if someone's putting pressure on you, etc., there are all sorts of circumstances where that judgment network becomes overactive and just says, no, no, okay. So basically, what that judgment network is the thing that seems to determine how apparently creative you are, because it will tend to reject ideas, even good ideas. Now, what does the judgment network rely on to make up its mind, so to speak, as to whether an idea is good enough or not? Well, there are two kinds of information. There's essentially what you've already got in your memory about things that will work. For example, if you want to build a bridge, you can't build it out of paper, for example. It knows those sorts of things, facts about a particular problem. But the other thing is that it relies on what people around you are also thinking. and saying. In other words, humans are social animals, and we pick up the attitude of those around us. We do this quite often, quite unconsciously. And that judgment network picks up automatically the attitude of those around you. You can call it groupthink, etc. Attitudes, conventions, etc. It picks those up, and it applies those as additional filters. In other words, it'll reject ideas if it thinks the rest of the people are going to say, no, that's a crap idea. Now, here's the point. People on the autistic spectrum have essentially are less sensitive to those influences around them. That's what causes them the problem. But at the same time, it gives them a unique freedom as well, because that judgment network now isn't, if you will, prejudging things on the basis of what people around them and the social context is. And so they have greater freedom of thought, and they come up with ideas and more or less see things literally outside the box that other people more or less have rejected unconsciously because it's not really the approach that's normally accepted.
But then they tend to blurt those things out, and sometimes they're considered brilliant, and sometimes it's like, well, yeah, Elon Musk, for example, you mentioned him earlier, has gotten in trouble a number of times, you know, just basically blurting stuff out either to reporters or on Twitter. That's part of this, right? Is it not?
I think there are probably other elements as well. I think that one of the things that high status and power does is it does also other things to your brain, but that's a completely different topic as well. I think that could be a factor also.
So having high status and power means that in order to survive, you no longer have to be so careful that you don't alienate others and you're not as dependent on others, so people become less inhibited?
This is really another topic, but it's one that I'm fascinated as to why people in power, particularly who achieve high status, seem to sometimes undergo a bit of a change of personality, become less empathic, become more intolerant, become more jerks, if you will. And there is a neural mechanism now people are beginning to sort of map out as to what happens. And I can go through some of that if you're interested.
That's fascinating. I think it's probably beyond where we're going today, but that correlates with those studies that found that where they were looking at traffic cameras, and they found that the more expensive the car, the more likely the driver was to break the law.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There's a link there. It involves the default mode network as well and empathy.
Yeah. With Professor Richard Silberstein. He is Professor Emeritus at Swinburne University in Melbourne, was former chair of the physics department, later the founding director of the Brain Sciences Institute there. Is the board chairman of neuro-insight.com, and on Twitter that's neuro_insight. Professor Silberstein, just to pick up where we kind of left off about 5 minutes ago, we have this default mode network that operates below the level of consciousness that's constantly coming up with ideas and putting things together and tossing them to another part of our brain, the judgment network. And I'm curious if there's an actual physical brain location associated with these. The judgment network that decides whether it's a good enough idea to toss up to consciousness, because this is all happening below consciousness, to toss up into consciousness so that we would suddenly say, whoa, I just got an idea. And are there brain areas associated with this? And number two, is it really that simple that if the judgment network is super active, basically we don't come up with a lot of creative ideas, and if its activity is somewhat suppressed, then we bubble with ideas?
The short answer to all those is yes. Look, let me just go into more detail. The judgment network is primarily on the left hemisphere. That's one that really does seem to be live on the left hemisphere, so to speak. It's primarily in the frontal part of the brain, what's called the inferior frontal cortex, and part of the temporal lobe as well, but sort of just on the side. And that's the region which seems to do the judging. Now, we know that, first of all, because if you damage those particular areas, or if they suffer degeneration, for example, there's a condition known as frontotemporal dementia, one of the things that can happen is people suddenly become extremely creative. Quite often they're artistic creative. But they come up with ideas or just new notions the whole time. In other words, brain damage actually makes them more creative. Now, the problem is that quite often the quality of the ideas is not terribly good. And their judgment network would have sort of said, no, that's just not good enough. Let's not pass that through to consciousness. But now they do. Now, now that's in extreme cases of brain damage, etc.
Phineas Gage.
But there are other things that can make you... Pardon?
I said Phineas Gage. My judgment network was not working well enough. Keep going.
That would be one. Although that was probably slightly more extreme. He had a full crowbar through his head. I think that's really going a bit hard to get creative. But there are other circumstances. For example, if you're more relaxed, and particularly if you're got a positive mood, feeling optimistic, that judgment network is less, if you will, anal retentive, less critical. Strangely enough, if you're a bit drowsy, in other words, now that judgment network, because it's evolved more recently, tends to be affected by things like drowsiness, lack of sleep. So you may find ideas popping in, for example, when you're drowsy. So those are the sort of circumstances that seem to increase the levels of the judgment network. There are cultural factors as well. It's been shown that, for example, if you measure people's creativity, it can vary depending on how strong cultural influences are, for example. So in more collectivist societies, for example, quite often the judgment network is just a bit stronger. These are relatively small effects. But there are cultural effects, but the individual effects seem to be the dominant ones. But there's no doubt that releasing or in some way even damaging the frontal judgment network makes you more creative. And there's some research taking place in different parts of the world, some in Australia as well, using weak electrical currents to, for example, weaken the strength of the judgment network slightly to see if that makes people more creative. And it does. It certainly does.
Professor Silberstein, we have just 1 minute left. What do we do with this knowledge?
Well, okay. Well, first of all, I think there are a number of areas by which this knowledge is important. First of all, I think looking at the way that society views non-neurotypical individuals, particularly people that have been referred to as Asperger's, as in some way deficient, I think these individuals have made some of the most remarkable contributions to civilization, and I think that should be sort of appreciated. And more to the point, I think there are probably ways of both education society, but also the individual, so that they can be taught some of the skills that are necessary to navigate, the world of social and other sorts of human relationships. The other thing is that creativity is becoming, if you will, the key currency of nations, the thing that determines ultimately the wealth. And I think understanding better the factors that contribute to creativity, particularly attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, because that association is there because of the link between the activity of the default mode network in both creativity and ADHD. And I'd like to sort of just point out again for the record, Thom, you were the first to actually point out the link between creativity and ADHD.